Hello and welcome to today's APA presentation, Social Media for Psychological Research in Ethical, Productive, and Prosocial Ways. I'm Peggy Mihalik, Senior Director of Member Content here at APA. Some important points before we get started. The views expressed in this presentation are those of the presenter and may not reflect the views or policies of the American Psychological Association. Next, this program does not offer CE, however, we will email everyone watching live today a certificate of attendance. During our time together, you will be on mute. You can communicate to us using the questions box located in your webinar control panel. And if you have a question for our presenter, type them in using the questions box, also located in your webinar control panel. And now for our speaker. Ian McRae is a workplace psychology expert, psychometrician, research consultant, and speaker across Europe and North America. He has written 6 books about workplace psychology, including High Potential, How to Spot, Manage, and Develop Talented People at Work, and his latest book, Dark Social, Understanding the Darker Side of Work, Personality, and Social Media. His books have been translated into 10 different languages. Ian has a bachelor's in psychology from the University of British Columbia and a master's in research methods in psychology from the University College London. Welcome, Ian.
Hi, thanks Peggy. I'm really happy to be here today and talking about social media in psychological research and the kind of ethical and productive elements of it. I was really happy to see there's so many attendees and really good questions. So I hope I'm going to answer as many questions as I possibly can today in the presentation. We're going to do some question and answer at the end, and I'm also going to send up some follow-up information. So hopefully I'm giving you as much information as possible, and this is really useful for everyone here. I'm not going to talk too much about my background and experience because Peggy's already introduced me very kindly, but I really want to talk about the opportunities for research and sharing information and the kind of advancement of psychological research ethically, constructively, pro-socially, and the opportunities we have to do that with the new and emerging tech that's available, especially on social media, because I think there's some real opportunities here to use it. There's also some risks and concerns that we should be aware of and we should think about. So I'm going to talk about a variety of different concepts from data collection. I'm going to focus on data collection really, but talk about participation and access to research, some of the ethical issues and opportunities there, ways you can share information and results, and some of the new kind of applications and innovation that's coming along in tech and psychology. And I'm going to have some kind of practical tips throughout, some guidance. And I'll also probably reference a couple of my books that have some useful and practical tips as well. So first, my background and experience. Peggy's already introduced me, so I can skip past that. My research is mostly on data research. A lot of it's on workplace psychology, organizational psychology, psychometrics. I've done a lot of work developing psychometric tests, particularly for personality, but also in motivation and resilience and some other topics. But the focus has been on the bright and the dark side of personality specific to the workplace. I'm going to try and talk about social media and research in the context that it might be useful outside of just organizational psychology. So hopefully I can have some tips and insight that's going to be useful, whatever your field or your background. I've done a lot of data collection and research over the last 10 plus years online. I've collected probably tens of thousands of results from participants online, some of it using social media, but some of it just using general electronic communication, survey techniques, and different tools and technology for that. So I've got a lot of experience collecting data in that way. I think it's really useful, it's really powerful, but there's a lot of stuff that we need to think about, especially as the technology evolves and changes, so we can make sure we're using it ethically, helpfully, and for the benefit of participants. I had a couple polls here. I'm not sure, can we do these now? Just about your background, I want a bit more information just about who's on the call, so I know specifically how I can give some advice or recommendations based on the kind of background of people who are here. So the first question is about what areas of psychology best describe your work. There's 5 options here. I know there's a much broader range of different backgrounds, but these are kind of the simplified versions. Thank you. Don't know if we have results coming in. Oh, there we go. Interesting. Okay. So almost half of the audience's background is in clinical psychology or cognitive psychology. So I will definitely keep that in mind. We've got about 36%, developmental psychology, evolutionary psychology, 15%, forensic and neuropsychology at about 9% and 9%. Okay. So that's really interesting. Thank you for that. I will try and make reference to clinical psychology as much as possible. The next question is a very simple question about, do you use social media, either personally or professionally? I'm just interested here to see what your experience is, what your background is with social media and how you're using it with either or both. So this one shouldn't take too long. We'll give you a couple more seconds and then wrap that up. You can select both if you use both personally and professionally, either or. So let's see what the answers are there. Okay, good. So a lot of you have experience, almost 90% have experience using social media personally. Professionally, it's about 62%. So a lot of you are using it professionally too. That's good, that's interesting. So that definitely can inform. This one's gonna be, the third question's an open answer one. So with a few choices. So which platforms do you use professionally? LinkedIn, TikTok, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Discord. Just check any and all that you've used professionally. I can guess which ones you probably use professionally versus personally, but I'm interested to see. All right, let's see what the results are for that one. LinkedIn makes sense. 75% of you are using LinkedIn professionally. It's a professional oriented platform, so that makes sense. Facebook and Instagram, about 50%. Cool. A lot of you are using that too. YouTube, Discord, Telegram, Slack, Teams, Reddit. That includes a lot of different platforms, but interesting that that's 30%. TikTok, 5% of you are using TikTok. Interesting. Professionally. Okay. So I am going to talk about some of those specific platforms later in the talk. I'm going to go over them briefly, but interesting to see that a lot of you are using social media, both personally and professionally. So that's really good to know. And I think I can talk about some of the nuance here and how to use these platforms. So first I want to talk about data collection. I think that's going to take up a decent amount of time because it is a key issue and it's a huge opportunity in using social media to collect data for your research studies, for whether you're doing psychometric development, whether you're doing clinical psychology research, if you're identifying groups who might participate in your research, then that's all a really interesting area. I know this is a really common challenge for psychologists. Most psychologists are interested in collecting data and sometimes struggle to find participants or really only focus on undergraduate students because those are the convenient samples that are available, but may struggle sometimes to get professional samples or clinical samples or really connect with the people who you want to be participating in your research. So I think one of the things that I want to encourage you to do is consider the entire area of research and the whole field of research in your project and what potential value participants might be getting out of your research, either the results or the field as a whole. Because if you can think about those potential results and what you can offer to people or what is going to make people's time worthwhile in participating in your research, then there's a lot more that you can do to encourage people to engage with both your research and your study individually, but the field as a whole online. And I think we have a huge opportunity as psychologists because a lot of people are interested in psychological research. A lot of people are interested more in the practical findings or the results of the research, you know, how it impacts them, what the effects could be on them or their relationships, their workplace, their well-being. But not everyone has the experience or the training or the history to understand necessarily the psychological concepts that we're talking about. So I think if you can find ways to make your study, your research, your field of research kind of interesting and accessible for people, people are going to be really keen to participate in research and advance the field and share their information and share their data in these kind of constructive and ethical ways. We have a challenge now with social media because there have been all sorts of unethical examples of it. I'm going to talk about unethical examples of data collection online. More people are concerned with protecting their data and personal information online than before, just because of some of the problems that have existed on different platforms. But I think there's still a role for making sure we're doing it in really ethical, constructive ways. And if you think about the value of your research, this is something that every research ethics board will ask in the forum. But I think we can go beyond that to consider what's the value for participants. You know, what's worth 10, 20, 30 minutes of someone's time, and what kind of information or insight or expertise can you provide people in return that might make them interested in participating in your research? So think about the real value and the practical implications for people and what you can provide in return to people in exchange for their participation. There's obviously limitations and benefits to convenience sampling. Doing that online is going to create some selection bias, sample bias potentially. Now there's ways you can try and reduce that bias, increase your representation in your target groups, but really think about what value you can add when you're conducting research online and when you're inviting people over social media that is going to get people's attention and time. So I mentioned this before, but you always see this in every form, every consent form, possible benefits. And usually it's relatively limited in studies and in research. And you say, when your participation is complete, you'll be given an opportunity to learn about this research. Sometimes I've seen that just being a link to the Research Ethics Board form. And that is not necessarily the most interesting, engaging, accessible information about your research or ways of kind of connecting with the findings of your research that participants are necessarily going to be interested in or able to understand. So I really want you to think when you're doing your research, is there more that you can do to create those opportunities to learn about research? Is there information you can give in different forms, on different channels, in different ways? Can you present the findings in a way that's going to be accessible to either the population you're working with, the population you're studying, or people who are going to be interested in participating in your research? And think about what they're getting in exchange, what they're getting as a possible benefit, and is that a sufficient benefit for most people? Because if you're advertising your studies online, if you're advertising them on specific groups or in online digital communities, on social media platforms, what is sufficient benefit for people that's going to be worth their time and their attention and their focus, even if it's 10 minutes? There's all sorts of distractions, there's screens, there's other stuff people have to occupy their time. But a lot of people are really interested in psychological research. So if you can find ways of describing and explaining your research in ways that are going to get people's attention in the limited capacity that they may have that on social media to participate in your study or to participate in the field of research, then I think that people will generally be interested. And I've found if you give people something in return, it might be a report for self-reflection, for understanding either of their personal results or of the research in general, then people are really interested and they will spend that time. But make sure you're considering what is interesting, accessible, useful to a general audience, and considering that people might be on their screens flicking through other information and there's a lot of competing stuff for their attention. So what can you do that is kind of honest, upfront, and ethical about advertising your study or the research or what you're trying to achieve with it, but also is providing some benefit in return? And I think there's a lot more that could be done in the field of psychological research to add those benefits to participants. And I think this is the main point, is that people do respond to real benefits. If there is really interesting information, if there's really practical findings from your research or from the field in general, it doesn't need to be the specific results of your research, it could be just new information to people, then people will respond to that really well. And they might share it with their friends or their colleagues, they might invite other people to participate in your research for you if there's a good reason for them to do it and they think it's a valuable use of their time. But all of this is really needs to consider that it's appropriate language, it's accessible, it's understandable to people, it makes sense on the forums or the channels that they're using, and it's consistent with the way other information is presented. Because if it's jarring or confusing or really complex or technical language, that accessibility is going to prevent or create a really high barrier to people engaging with your research. So make sure you're thinking about what the opportunities are. One of the most attractive things to people is personal results. So I do this when I'm developing psychometrics is from the very get-go, as soon as you've got a kind of a sample of data and you understand kind of your factor structure and you can have reasonable results with a report for personalized reports based on people's personality results, then people are really, really interested in those personal results. So if you can say, here's where you're scoring on these personality factors, say it's the big five, or kind of subclinical personality disorders, you can say, here's where you're scoring compared to the general population. Here's what this means about understanding yourself or understanding other people, understanding relationships at work. Then people are really, really interested in that. And if you can provide that feedback, then you're gonna get a lot better response to people, you know, completing your questionnaire, participating in your research, or sharing their data with you about whatever your topic is. But the more you can make it directly relevant and some level of customization about people's specific results, the higher engagement you're going to get, the more attractive that is going to be to people. And fortunately, with some of the tech and tools available online, creating these customized reports based on specific scoring levels and ranges and data is relatively straightforward to do compared to how it would have been 20 or 30 years ago. I mean, even 10 years ago when I was doing digital research, the tools you have for presenting feedback and results back to people are fantastic compared to where they were before. So I think there's huge opportunities here. And if you can give people that meaningful personal information or feedback, then there's some more opportunity for them to participate. And then if there's even more opportunities for further participation, for discussion, if you're doing follow-up research or workshops or conversations with people so they can learn more about your research and the field, then that's going to be really attractive to people. And you won't always necessarily have personalized feedback or reports or individual results that you can present. But if you're talking about either your research or the field in general, what can you do to make the findings of that field interesting and personally relevant to people? You know, if you're in workplace psychology, that's often things about productivity or workplace well-being. But if you're looking outside of the workplace, things about relationships, interpersonal relationships, what do we know about, you know, the cognitive psychology of attention and focus is interesting to a lot of people. What about your field of research is something that the random person on the street would actually be interested to know, or would actually help them in their everyday life and managing their relationships with other people, managing their productivity, managing their focus, attention, whatever it is, there's usually some practical implications. And sometimes I see in the research, the practical implications in, you know, academic papers are explained very well, but sometimes not accessible to someone who doesn't have that background in training in psychology. So really think through what you can do to make it more interesting. And sometimes engaging more with people on social media and seeing how people talk about these issues outside of psychology, but in everyday conversation, will give you a lot of clues to what people are interested in. So a lot of you use Twitter. I think it was about a third of you use Twitter. Sometimes you can see these trending topics related to mental health, where the conversation is going, what is good information that people are sharing or talking about, what are some misconceptions. Sometimes that's a good way to approach giving people information, is saying, here's some of the misconceptions, and this is what you're doing, you might be doing better to understand yourself or your brain or your cognition or whatever it is, but making sure it's accessible and understanding how to present it in the language that people are using in their everyday life or on social media. And I'm not talking about reducing the quality of the recommendations, but distilling it in a way that it's accessible to people. The more you can do that, the easier it's going to be to connect with people. So understanding those practical implications. And understanding how people access information. So there's a huge amount of psychological research that would be so useful to people, but it needs to be distilled into ways and platforms and channels that people are using. So I'm going to talk about some other channels in a bit that are useful, but understanding how people consume information and read shorter articles or look at infographics. Sometimes explanatory videos are really good. I do some of those. Interactive elements, sometimes conversationally, you can do, you know, follow-ups to study and have a panel discussion or a Q&A on social media, things like that. But understanding how people access information, where they're seeking out information, because a lot of people look for information on social media, and then connecting with people there can help to get people interested in your area of research, your specific study, and then you can place some of your research in that context. And I do want to stress that you don't need to sacrifice the quality of the content, but just think of ways to enhance the quality, the depth, and the richness of information, to present it in other ways. ways. If you've got data, how can you visualize it in a way that might show up well in social media, and then link to the full research, the reports, whatever more complex depth of information you have. So there were some questions about this initially, and when you're talking about connecting with people online, I really want to talk about the importance of distinguishing between personal and professional profiles. I know on social media, it can get a bit messy and it can get a bit mixed, but I think if you're using social media professionally, you really want to consider why you're using it, what you're using it for, and how much, if at all, you want your personal and professional information to overlap or be combined or be present online. I know I've used social media for pretty much as long as most of it's been available, the ones that kind of exist today. And when I started, it was very much a personal use kind of thing, you know, Facebook and stuff for talking with people in university and friends and connections. And as my career's grown, I've completely got rid of the personal use for social media because it's too complex and it's too messy, and I don't want to have a lot of that information online publicly available as these platforms have gotten so big and so much more complex and with all sorts of other issues associated with them. But that's a personal decision for what I want to use social media for. I'm quite happy to have my work online and, you know, the research that I'm conducting shared on my social media profiles, digitally online, connect up with other information. But I just don't want those personal profiles out there. A lot of you who are clinical psychologists, if you're psychotherapists or psychiatrists, there's probably a lot of guidelines and recommendations about having your public information available, and you probably don't want to have that, right? A lot of people use social media personally to share things about their family and where they're going on vacation and things they're buying, things they like, their personal interests. As a clinician, you probably don't want to have a lot of that information online. It's probably counterproductive, if not destructive, to have some of that information publicly available, connected with your professional profile or your practice. So really think about that and how much information you're comfortable with sharing online and what you think is constructive to have online. I've had this conversation with a few close friends who are teachers, and one of the things that they've said they do is they do have personal profiles, but they don't use their real name. They don't have any of their personal information publicly available. So they have these profiles that are personal, but they're not publicly available, accessible, because students will go on and find that information, and it's probably not ideal to have that personal information publicly available when it mixes with your professional life. It's interesting from the perspective of, you know, social media marketers would tell you to be as upfront and share as much personal information as possible, give people insight into your perspective and share all of that. But for psychologists, I don't think generally that's always good advice. It may be if you're an academic or if you're sharing some of that personal information is not going to create problems professionally, then maybe you're okay to do some of that. But really, really think carefully and consider how much you want to be public versus private, and how much of your professional versus personal information you have online. And for psychologists, I would say generally err on the side of caution. The other thing I'm really careful about is because I work with a lot of different occupations and groups, and I want to make sure that nothing politically, ideologically is online on my social media profile, because sometimes it's relatively straightforward to connect with people when you're talking about issues like workplace well-being or health and wellness at work or psychological strategies for managing resilience, all of this stuff. But if you have all of that other stuff online, often people will look you up, they'll find the information, and they'll make judgments about you or your work or how you're approaching things before. And if you're couching things in that language, or you have that kind of stuff about you on the internet that you're really publicly discussing, it can color a lot of other stuff about your work. So you may not want to have that there if it's not going to help with your interactions with clients or patients or whoever you're working with. So really think carefully about what you want to have online versus what you don't. And it's a dynamic process too, that can change. So I'm going to briefly mention this. I'm sure a lot of you have heard about Cambridge Analytica, have read about it, have considered it, the ethical implications of it. The very short version of this is Cambridge Analytica was an app on Facebook that was doing personality profiling. And they were harvesting data from people who were, you know, completing a short questionnaire, but they were also harvesting data from all of people's connections. So ethically, obviously massive problems with collecting data from people without consent. You never want to do that. You want to make sure you're fully obtaining informed consent from everyone, that you're going through all of the ethical procedures to make sure people understand what data you're collecting from them, what you're storing, how it's being used, if it's being transferred and sold, all of those details. Cambridge Analytica kind of did a checklist of everything you shouldn't necessarily do. What they did really well is they provided a very kind of short, easily accessible product that people liked. So they give people personality test reports based on Big Five. And people really like that. And they like to share that and talk about their results and share it with their friends and all of that. And that's a really, really effective thing that they did. The kind of developing profiles isn't a problem, but the way they were collecting data and then who they were selling the data to were a big problem. I know there was a big discussion about their role in election interference and kind of campaigning, and I don't think I ever saw any really good predictive validity about whether their tool could actually influence people's voting behavior. If anyone has that information, send it to me. But it does raise those really interesting issues about data harvesting, about consent, about data, about being upfront with participants about what you're collecting, what you're using it for, and eventually what the end product of that data is going to be, especially if it's not clear in the initial kind of process of signing up and clicking yes on an app. So I think from Cambridge Analytica, there is stuff to learn about offering content or products that people would like and are interested in, but that's with all of the provisos that you have to be very careful about managing consent and data protection. And that is so important, because the problem with those kind of ethical violations is, as we've seen from those cases, is it really undermines trust. And it's hard to recover that. And, you know, Facebook's had that ongoing problem now with people worried about where their data is being processed, used. And I think it's good in one sense that people are more aware of being careful about their data and who they're sharing with it and who they're giving access to it. But when you have these kind of scandals, it has a really negative impact on overall trying to work with people and develop psychometric profiles in ethical ways. So when we're talking about participation and access, I think social media is a really, really, really valuable opportunity in connecting with sometimes underrepresented or underserved or groups, especially if they're on social media or there's specific, you know, organizations, community groups, forums, platforms, whatever they are, for people of specific interests and in specific communities and whatever it is, there's almost always a community online for it. So a big part of this is understanding your audience. I was talking about understanding your audience in the general population, but you might want to also do a lot to understand specific groups and looking at specific groups online versus offline, but tie this back into your strategy about who you're connecting with, what kind of information you're presenting, and if it really fits with the population you're looking at. So social media can be a really useful tool for connecting with underrepresented groups. It is more and more now that more people online, as we saw from your poll results, about 90% of you are on social media. I think that's slightly higher than the average in the population, but about 90% of people have good internet access. The only issue I want to raise here is that some groups are not as connected, are not as available on social media. So there's certain groups that are really difficult to access on social media or connect with on social media. There's some groups that are much easier. I've worked with some populations before, subgroups that if you want participation, you absolutely have to do it in person. And you generally have to go through community leaders to make sure that people are participating and they understand the value of the research. It's not so much as sending out an email. It takes a lot more work and effort to get people to participate in research or these processes or, you know, plans to collect people's data or to work with people about getting their information and doing that research. So understand what the demographics are of that group and whether they're primarily online, offline, and how you get the balance with those. So do you have to go in person to work with these groups, or do they have really active kind of population subgroups online? The other thing is that no group is completely homogenous either. So you may find if you've got a specific group or a community that maybe it's more of the younger people in that group who are online, whereas the older people, you still have to go in person to have paper surveys or have specific data collection processes that work in person versus online, but understanding how to connect with those groups. So I've said traditional influencers on this slide, but what I mean by influencers is not people who are kind of walking billboards on Instagram, but people who have influence within a specific community, within a group, are trusted and understood by that community or group. So these can be community, local leaders, religious leaders, whatever it is, whatever your specific population is, understanding who people listen to in that group. And this is a really useful opportunity for working with this group when you can understand not just who you need to go to send out a questionnaire or a survey, but if you can get deeper into the conversations about what kind of language is useful, what kind of language is accessible, what people want to see from the research, what people would want to express in the research, if it's beyond just a quantitative questionnaire. And the more you can have that kind of back and forth dialogue with people and understand about what are the particular interests and priorities and concerns of the group, the better able you will be to, you'll be able to engage with that group and talk about what specifically is going to be of interest, what's going to get the most participation, and if you can go online or offline. Now, there's a lot of really good opportunities online with communities who usually have some sort of informal or formal leaders on the platforms. If you're looking at, you know, discussion forums or boards, sometimes those are the moderators, sometimes those are the organizers of the group, and you can talk to them first to say, okay, what's the best way to approach this research? Is this something that we could post on your community? We could ask you to send out, get people to participate in, and how should we do that? What's the best form, channel, communication strategy to do that and to get that out there? And the more kind of dialogue you can have, the better able you will be to tailor it specifically to your audience. And when you're looking at what would be valuable in return, what do people want for their participation, or what kind of positive, meaningful impact you can have, then you can get that right up front and say, okay, well, to do this, maybe we should do a workshop or an educational session with this group, or a webinar, it could be in person, it could be digital, to talk about this research and what we're trying to do, what we're trying to achieve, what we're trying to learn, and information that we can give back to participants. Because sometimes that'll be really well received, but you can go to these kind of influencers or group leaders, administrators, whoever they are, who have that influence and understand what would be valuable and useful. So social media influencers or influencers can mean a lot of different things. I kind of covered that. The people with the kind of formal administrative influence are not necessarily always the people who can get people out to complete a questionnaire or participate in your research or the process. I'm going to quickly go through the channels. I want to leave some time for questions because we've got a lot of really good questions, but I've organized these into kind of three key themes and choosing what channels you want to use. So profile-based social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, these all focus on a kind of profile of an individual person. You probably got information about you, what you're doing, and then you've got these kind of feeds alongside of them with constantly updated information. These ones are interesting. They're not always the best way to connect with people because sometimes they're more about individual profiles than the content. I'm just going to go to the next slide. Sometimes these channels that are more about discussion than individual profiles can be a really valuable tool in a different way than the profile-based ones. So anyone who works in companies and organizations may have been on Slack or Teams channels. These can be really useful if you're working as part of a longer-term project, because then if you understand how people are using these digital communication tools in their work, in their daily communication, and sometimes that's a much better place to talk with people and get people interested in either your project or what you're doing than email. Discord tends to be a more tech-focused one, but it's growing. It tends to be community and server based, so a lot of different communities, more so in the tech sector, but have specific interest groups related to Discord channels. So if you have a specific community you're doing research with, often there'll be a Discord channel there. So if you can find that, sometimes those are useful places to see what kind of dialogue is going on and maybe talk to the administrators or managers or whoever's hosting it to see if that's a community that you can participate in or use your research with. Obviously, there's the messaging based ones. I put Reddit there because it does have a lot of really community-focused groups. All of these, I should say with the proviso, that all of them have their own demographic profiles, interests, leadings. None of these are unbiased samples. So understand when you go to a specific community or group or even on a general social media platform, they all have slightly different inclinations or different kind of essentially digital cultures. With subgroups in those cultures. But sometimes seeing the discussion-based communities can be interesting to see how people are talking about issues, what those users are talking about, what's kind of interesting, relevant, what is a priority for them. That's not to say it's always necessarily true or fact-based, but seeing the discussion can be sometimes useful in understanding how to inform your research and the findings and how you talk about it. Then there's these three, which are the video-based ones. I included TikTok and Snapchat just because they're becoming really, really prevalent. I think TikTok is now in the sixth or seventh most used social media platform. It tends to be a much younger audience. I don't have any experience using it, so I can't talk with much authority about specific uses for that. But it tends to be a primarily younger audiences, video-based content, and a lot of interaction on it. So one of the things is, I would say there's significant privacy and data protection concerns with TikTok, even more so than some of the other platforms. They've got a lot of issues and lawsuits, both in Europe and the US, about data protection, especially in relating to young people's data. So this is a kind of concern on all of the platforms about sharing information and data protection and not putting private information or confidential information, even in personal messages, on any of these channels. But TikTok is one to be aware of and just be concerned about. If I had to place a bet on what the next big data scandal is going to be, it's probably TikTok, but I could be wrong. YouTube is more of a broadcasting platform, so it can be really useful for posting information in kind of video format instead of written format. A lot of people like that information in that format. Sometimes it's really good to have that complementary kind of format or information about your research or about the content, supplementing whatever other written materials you have. Some people just connect with that more or get more interested in video content than written content. And for people with lower reading levels, that can be really useful too, is to have video content. Snapchat is there because it kind of fits the theme. I don't think there's a lot of good professional uses for Snapchat, but someone correct me if I'm wrong. And interestingly, I want to talk about social media and traditional media because the distinction between the two is becoming less and less clear. Most traditional media channels are really active on social media. Social media definitely feeds the discourse in traditional media, and the reverse is true. But if you're finding ways to connect with your audiences and to encourage participation in research, have people complete questionnaires, participate in that, there's a whole positive cycle you can get going with between social media and traditional media. And I think in my experience, trade associations, specialized magazines, occupational or interest-focused magazines are a much better resource, and you get much higher engagement and interest than kind of general bigger media sources. Because if you can connect with people who are really focused on a specific interest or topic or profession, organization, then there's a lot more you can do to provide kind of interesting, valuable information to them. And they're probably more willing to participate in research that is focused if it's tailored specifically to them. I mean, even sometimes focusing on a specific occupation or group can be really useful. I've done that before and just written up, you know, personality research connecting with certain professions, and work with colleagues who may be accountants or lawyers and are really interested in how a specific area of research works with their profession, and then interpreting those results from the context of, you know, maybe personality characteristics of lawyers or leaders and lawyers. And then if you're working with someone who can write that up in that certain way and say, participate in the research, here's, this is of interest specifically for this profession, you can get much higher uptake when the results or when the discussion or when the research is specifically tailored to that. And then you maybe want to use those specific occupational groups as part of a bigger sample or a bigger group. But the more interesting, relevant, and specifically you connect with certain people with certain interests, the higher the uptake you're going to get. So again, in this, understand your potential participants, understand why and how people have influence online, what communities are relevant, and make sure you're using and choosing the right platforms. There's no hard and fast rules to specifically what platform is right for psychologists or correct in general, especially because these platforms change, but understand who is using the platforms, where they're going, and how they're using, sharing, and processing information. Sharing information and results. I've already talked about this quite a bit, but I think the more you can do to share kind of that, the findings and the results, not just in application, academic publications for specific audiences, which is great. That's a core part of the research, and that, you know, that format is extremely valuable, but your general population is never going to read those academic studies or peer-reviewed papers. So figure out ways that you can write them up for applied publications. And I've found magazine editors in specific areas or niche areas are often really interested in talking about the research. So if you're not sure how to get started, but you have a piece of research or an area of research that you think would be really useful for a specific field or organization or that kind of area, then sometimes you can talk that through and say, okay, what kind of language are people going to use to talk about this? What are the key questions you constantly get asked but never get answered? I always have editors saying to me, what are the practical implications of this? So if you're trying to get your research in 600 to 800 words with practical implications and results that people can use right now, it can be challenging. But if you can figure out what a few of those things are, then you're going to have a really significant edge, because there's a lot of competition for space and time and pages in these publications. But if you can get those practical results, that's going to make a huge difference for readers, for getting accepted into a kind of trade publications, applied publications. And then it's going to give you potentially interesting information to see what people are connecting with. And so publishing results, again, exactly the same thing, but you know, if you're posting things like infographics on social media or condensing your information into really clear, practical ways and then linking up with other content, whether it's in academic publications for people who are really interested in all the detail or some of the applied publications, then you can find ways and channels that are most effective, but hopefully providing that depth of information and that context and linking to it when it's appropriate. Use all the same channels. This is fairly straightforward guidance, I would say, but if you're recruiting people on Twitter, make sure you have links to your results on Twitter. Make sure you're sending the results to the same people who participated in your research, and find ways of communicating the information and the results and the findings, the practical implications on the same channel. And you can always link to other stuff. If you've got an institutional website, a professional website, whatever it is, you can link between those and whatever channels you're using to recruit participants. But make sure you're sharing, disseminating, and discussing the results of your research on the same channels. You're taking back to the same people who participated. And you'll find that that potentially gets you more participation in future if you've got more research or follow-up research, or you want to do it in different ways. The other thing to remember is not all social media happens publicly. I find if I'm working with magazine articles or media, often it's not always best to do that publicly. And then not that what you're hiding what you're doing, but stuff doesn't need to happen publicly, right? So if you're organizing interviews or asking magazine editors if they want to publish a bit of your content or sending pitches or doing that stuff, sometimes it's better just to message them directly and move it to email. The other thing to remember is making sure you're not sharing information that should be confidential or private. So if it's any of that information, you want to move it off even direct messages to secure communication platforms, because you have to assume with everything on social media that potentially someone else could see it, it could get leaked, people get hacked, people lose their accounts, all of that stuff. So make sure if it's more appropriate to be private communication, or if you're trying to directly communicate with someone, it doesn't necessarily need to be public. Sometimes problems occur when people are talking not to each other but at each other. So if you're trying to use like Twitter as an address book, for example, then maybe it's better to do it privately instead of publicly. So there's some guidelines here. Sometimes there's no benefit to having an audience. If you're talking directly with someone, it may not be necessary to be having the conversation publicly. Sometimes you can discuss things that are more, maybe more sensitive or confidential if you're not doing it publicly. Sometimes on social media platforms, people are grandstanding, or they're having a discussion not with you, but to someone else who's their kind of intended audience. So sometimes it's better to just do that when it's, you know, appropriate and ethical. I'm not saying necessarily have shady conversations and direct messages. But you can think about this whole process of informing potential future participation, presenting results, getting people engaged in the research, but also getting people interested in the field in general and showing people where they can find more information, get more feedback, learn more about the topics if they're really interested. Because I find there's always people who are interested. There's always people, even if it's only a few people, who want to learn more, who want more references, more resources, who are really interested in the complexity. Some people want a, you know, quick snapshot of it. Some people want more depth. But sometimes people will continue to participate in research, especially if you have kind of follow-up studies. One of the things I do in psychometric development is after I've done the quantitative research, I do a lot of qualitative research. And usually people who have participated in the initial research might be really interested in having a feedback session or a discussion of the results or a discussion of their results specifically. And you can get really valuable information and have really interesting discussions that give you a lot of context for the research and people's behaviors or cognition or emotion, if you have those direct conversations in the context of giving feedback on results. It's also a key part of the ethical process of giving people opportunity to discuss their results, learn more information. If they have any questions, get in touch with you directly. I pretty much always make that offer. Whether I'm doing a workshop alongside a piece of research or collecting quantitative data, to have those follow-up conversations, or that's part of the process. And again, usually if you're doing this in an ongoing way, I think a lot of you who are doing research probably have ongoing studies and follow-up studies and more complexity to the research. So offer opportunities to future participation. Sometimes this is a tick box at the end of a questionnaire. Would you be interested in participating in future research? I find normally between about 15 to 30% of people say yes. Sometimes it's more. The more direct contact you have with people, the more you've kind of done a workshop or something in person, often you get a lot more interest. But offer those opportunities to either share your information about your research, because a lot of people will be interested in the findings, or also get feedback on the research, because sometimes people will have comments about what they've been asked or how they've been asked it. And that can be really useful information too. So general tips there, think about your publication channels, connections between social and traditional media. They're becoming more and more intertwined, so you can get a really positive feedback loop going if you have a lot of interest in a particular profession or from a particular interest group or population that you're studying. So try and keep that connection going, because keeping it alive can be really, really useful, both for you and for the participants. And I think the more you can think about what value people are getting out of participating in the research, the better. And the other thing is the ongoing conversation. It can be really useful to understand how people describe themselves in their own words. I know if you're writing personality test reports, understanding how people are describing themselves is very, very useful and helpful. So a cautionary tale, this is one that you've probably mostly heard of too, Internet Research Agency. This is one of Russia's propaganda groups that has been really active in influence campaigns. As far as I know, they're still ongoing. They're probably very busy right now. But one of the things that they did is they ran a whole bunch of social media groups and communities, and were not apparent about who they were. So they were targeting different, you know, ethnic and minority groups, as well as certain political affiliations. And what they were actually doing really effectively, although not ethically, is most of the content they were producing was not related to the kind of core message or disinformation campaigns that they pushed later. There's some really good information about this. There was a House and a Senate report on this that gives the tactics in real detail. I'll send the links out if you're interested in that. But they use bait and switch tactics. So they'd use kind of memes and popular images and kind of popular topics and everyday discussions to get people, millions and millions of people following these channels. Probably a lot of them were, you know, fake likes and whatever, but also they were getting a lot of interest and attracting people based on fairly benign content, but then switched it out later. So what they did is they built up these huge, huge, huge engaged user bases. And then when a particular kind of event, like an election happened, all of a sudden it switched to political content. So they created these huge followings, but were not upfront about what they were trying to do, the information they were trying to gather, or later the information they were trying to push out. So that's an interesting ethical conundrum of saying, okay, if you're managing these social media profiles, you do have to be ethical about what the purpose of them is, about telling your users who you are, what you're doing, where the money's coming from, if there's funding behind it, if participants are being paid for research, if you're communicating certain messages, if you're funded by an organization or a company, really being ethical and transparent about where that money is coming from. Now, what they did really effectively is using benign content to draw in users and then later put out different information, different messages. There's nothing technically wrong with not having all of your content be focused on one issue, as long as you're really apparent about why you're sharing information. You know, some of it might be memes about like, oh yeah, Mondays, blah, blah, blah. And that gets a lot of likes and attention if they're kind of popular, funny, interesting, quick and easy. But if you're doing that to get attention, you have to make sure that you're really, really honest about who you are and what you're trying to achieve with your social media profile. I don't think that's very complex. I know there's a lot of interesting stuff about their tactics, because a lot of it wasn't necessarily illegal, but highly unethical. So I want to make time for questions. I'm going to briefly mention this, just some of the interesting emerging areas that you see on social media for online data collection, harvesting, Mental health apps are a huge growth industry. Some of them are really practical, really good, really useful. There's some mental health apps that are designed by people who have no training in psychology or psychometrics or data collection, maybe less unethical, less evidence for their validity. I put blockchain in here because I think there's some really interesting consequences related to data protection, ownership of data, sharing data that's coming down the pipeline. I think this is an area of interest that's going to be a lot more relevant than even things like the metaverse, but a lot of it is in its infancy. So it's something to keep an eye on. I want to encourage people to learn about some of this tech, to be interested in it, to be curious about it, not necessarily engage with it all immediately, but understand what's coming along and look at, you know, how it could impact, you know, medical data or testing services or how we process and share information. That could be a whole separate webinar, but I just want to encourage everyone who's come here today. I know you're clearly curious about social media, about tech, about all of the areas that are coming down the pipeline. So whether or not you're using it, stay interested in it. Look at it all through the lens of psychological ethics, about using it in pro-social versus kind of antisocial or destructive ways, and consider the potential implications for it, even if you're not using it, because sometimes there'll be really interesting opportunities. So I just want to say that the role of psychologists in navigating how technology and business influence human behavior online is so profound. It's going to impact so much. It already has. It's going to impact a lot more. And I really want to encourage psychologists to have a positive, constructive, and ethical input into these areas, because sometimes I can see these, you know, tech or apps being developed that are having psychological impacts, but with very little psychological expertise and input on the projects. So whether you're, you know, writing for trade publications or industry magazines or connecting with people on social media and discussing these topics, I really want to encourage you to keep learning about it, keep having an input, and understand the value of your expertise and your knowledge in shaping in all of these developing texts. So, based it on the guiding principles, the APA does have a new set of guidelines, I think that was just published in October, about using social media. So keep looking at those, check those out, and make sure you're considering that in your work, in your research, and whatever you're doing. And definitely be an advocate for the role of psychologists in tech, if it's you or if it's people you know who are really good at it. I want to open it up to questions now. I've been over the guiding principles. I think I've mentioned all of that. Oh, I do want to quickly mention two books. I've got Myths of Social Media, which is a very practical guide to using social media in your work for either talking about your work or learning how to use different platforms or stuff. Dark Social is more of a kind of social guide for how it's used in communication tech, and especially the role of understanding personality online and in the workplace. I'm going to send you some follow-up information too, some free resources about social media that might answer some of the questions that I didn't get to. But yeah, let's open it up to general questions now.
Thank you, Ian, for that was a really informative presentation. And just to let the audience know that you can download his presentation slides from the webinar control panel under handouts. It will either download to your desktop or to your downloads folder. If you have any trouble downloading his presentation, not to worry, we will include that with the recording that we will send out with some of the resources that Ian mentioned in a couple of weeks. So let's get to some of these questions because we've got a lot. Okay, first one, what are the easiest ways to start using social media for psychological research that do not violate ethical codes? And this person mentions, I have no institutional review board to help.
That's an interesting question. I'm also sometimes in the situation of not having an institutional review board. Sometimes working with colleagues who are experts in either reviewing ethical documents or understanding that, sometimes it's good to have conversations with colleagues, have someone else review your research, review your process, review what you're trying to do to get feedback on that. Sometimes the process of explaining it to someone else brings up some issues that you want to think about or that you might want to work with. The other thing is I'd recommend if you're not comfortable with social media is start off with an anonymous profile and just look at what happens. Follow some people who you think are good examples of ethical behavior online, or really good researchers who use social media, and just see how people are using it in their practice and kind of base your guidelines on that too. That can be really helpful. So follow people who you think are good examples and then always talk stuff through with colleagues if you don't have an institutional research board necessarily to review your work.
Okay. How do we ask for informed consent in an ethical way among social media users?
Yeah, you can do that basically in the same way you would sending out any questionnaire. So if you're directing people to a questionnaire, then make sure you have that informed consent initially. So you might have a description of the research, what the benefits are, what you're going to ask people about. Just make sure you're explaining it in kind of every opportunity in every way so people understand what's happening. And don't use those tiny little fonts in kind of click agree to accept without skipping them. Make sure you're presenting it in easily accessible, readable, understandable ways, in the same way you would for an academic research project.
Okay, now we have a couple questions on trolls and bots. So let's start with trolls. Have you noticed trolls seeking to lure professionals to give unethical responses online and attempting to normalize pathology?
I've seen a bit of that. Interestingly, I don't think it's as rampant necessarily as some people would worry about. It is there and it's a problem, but that's why I would say be really clear about what you're setting out to do online and what your kind of personal and professional boundaries are on social media. So you know if you're getting drawn off topic, then don't necessarily. The thing that I've noticed more so than trolls is sometimes people will engage in conversations because they have a particular product to sell, or they want to challenge you to be the person who is kind of the opposite of that, or they're trying to direct other people to them or their product or their service or whatever it is. So, yeah, don't necessarily get drawn into those arguments online, especially realizing that sometimes people who are kind of trolling or aggressive or pushing a really strong agenda, it's not really about you or what you're doing online. They're trying to define themselves in opposition to you. So, try and spot it and don't engage in it if it gets silly.
Okay. What are the best ways to eliminate bots or bogus completion of online survey research surveys?
Yeah, I've had this problem, but it hasn't been too serious with bots. Usually you get kind of bots and crawlers registering to sites and checking stuff out if there's vulnerabilities. But usually, you know, CAPTCHAs, there's some basic security measures you can take to avoid those. It doesn't usually need to be too complex to outsmart the bots. So just make sure you've got some of those security processes in place. If you're designing your own data collection software, make sure that part of your security is an important part of it. But generally, I found it hasn't been too hard to avoid.
Okay. How can we avoid selection bias when recruiting participants through social media?
Yeah, there's limits to how much you can reduce that, but a big part of it is knowing what the general audience or what the general population is like on a platform. So whether if some of them tend to have a significant bias in one direction or another, be aware of that. I always collect demographic data and control for it because then you can see too if you are collecting data that tends to be heavily biased from one group or another. And that may be why you want to look at branching out to different platforms. Maybe you don't want to do only online versus only in person. So just balancing it out in those ways. And if you're collecting the data to understand whether or not there is bias in your samples, then that's going to help you a lot. So make sure you're doing that because you can spot it coming.
Okay. When trying to reach specific populations, do you have any suggestions for how to approach Facebook group admins or specific influencers? This person says they tried to do this when recruiting participants previously, but many of these individuals' group admins did not respond.
Yeah, so I mean, that's one of the challenges that you're always going to have online is that some people will respond, some people won't. Generally, one of the things I'd say is keep your requests really clear and concise. Link to more information if you need to, but in my experience, whether it's group admins or magazine editors or whoever you're trying to kind of pitch to or approach, make sure it's really clear what you're trying to do and it's easy to say yes. In the sense of it's really obvious what you're asking for, and don't send people walls of texts and 400 or 4,000 page essays about what you're trying to do with your project. Give people that information once it's appropriate and once there's opportunities with links. But the quicker and the more efficient you can be in your communication, the easier it's going to be. Because a lot of these people are getting a lot of messages and they're dealing with a lot of content. So be honest, be clear, be concise, and then once people are interested, then you can give more information as appropriate.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about results with the time remaining ticking down. How do you analyze results if participants are recruited through social media and other traditional methods? So you have a blend.
Yeah, so I always code for that. So if you're using different sources, make sure you're coding in your data where the sources are coming from, because then you can analyze whether there's a clear bias or difference between different groups. Sometimes I use different links on different platforms, so it's really clear who's coming from where. And if you're collecting that demographic and background data as well as the source, then you can analyze that and compare whether or not it's representative of the population.
Okay. Should we only utilize professional social media accounts when disseminating results or recruiting participants?
Yeah, that's a good question. I would say generally lean towards only using professional networks. Now, there may be situations where using personal networks might be fine, where you might want to share that with your personal networks. But again, be really clear about what you're trying to accomplish, what your research is and why, and whether or not it's appropriate to be sharing on personal networks versus professional networks.
Okay, we only have time for this last question here. How do you see psychology as a field advancing ethical practices in social media research?
I think the ethical guidelines for psychologists should be followed by pretty much everyone who's collecting, processing, analyzing data online. I would really like to see, there has been a lot of activity and a lot of really positive input from the APA about this, and I think it's one of the leaders when the European Union had new data protection guidance and rules a couple of years ago, and it was basically all bringing stuff up to the psychologist code for processing using data. So I would like to see those ethical codes and guidelines really continue to be an important influence for any sort of data protection and processing and information and people's personal data online.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, we have run out of time. Thank you so much for joining us, Ian. Such a pleasure to have you and have you share your knowledge with us today.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's so interesting. I'm glad to see so many people are interested in this topic.
And thank you to our listeners for your participation and all of your questions. We're sorry we could only get to a fraction of them. A recording of this presentation, including the slides and some useful information, resources that Ian has gathered, will be emailed to everyone in about 2 weeks. As soon as the webinar has ended, a short survey will appear on your screen. We hope you'll take a few minutes to complete the survey and give us feedback on how we did and how we can improve these presentations. Please be on the lookout for more exciting membership webinars in 2022. We thank you for your attention today and hope you have a great day.